Welcome to Salt and Pep with Harish Bijoor. Today I am in the cozy living room of Subroto Bagchi, gardener at Mindtree, and of course the vice chairman. Subroto Bagchi calls himself gardener, and if you really look at it, if I was to refer to you, if you had a Hindi visiting card, Subroto, I would need to say Subroto Bagchi Mali.
Yes.
If you had a Kannada visiting card,
yes,
I would have to say Subroto Bagchi Totagara.
Yeah.
And vice chairman.
Yes.
How did this title come about?
But first let me tell you this little anecdote. You know, after I became the gardener, one of my co-founder's wife, Purba, called up Sushmita, my wife, and said, how do I tell people who is coming home for dinner henceforth? Can I, you know, with this designation be saying that, you know, the gardener of Mindtree and his wife are coming for dinner? So, you know, Sushmita had a hearty laugh and said, yes, why not?
Yeah.
And more than me becoming the Mali, you know,
yeah,
she becomes the Malan now.
Okay.
But on a more serious note, you know, I moved on for the last 3 years to take on leadership development for the top 100 people.
Sure.
Now, we believed that, you know, at that level, you cannot do what you call sheep dipping,
right,
in New Zealand, where,
right,
you know, you take hundreds of sheep,
right,
and then dip them in a color and,
right,
they come out,
right,
in one color.
Right.
At a very senior level, leadership is about an inner capacity.
Right.
You don't bring out outstanding leaders who can lead the company for the next 10 years in a mass manner.
Right.
Okay. It has to be through capacity building, one person at a time.
Right.
And it cannot just be by looking at the individual's profession or professional needs, because we believe that there is porosity between personal life of an individual and the professional life.
Sure.
So we said that one of us founders will have to devote full time towards a partly structured and partly unstructured program of long-term development.
Right.
We stepped back and said, what do we call this guy? So, you know, there is no precedent to building something like,
sure,
this. This is not about coaching and mentoring,
right,
because we believe that coaches and mentors have to be in your line of work.
Right.
And sometimes I'm dealing with people whose line of work and my line of work are vastly different, because it's a super specialized arena. Okay, IT.
Right.
So I'm not a coach, I'm not a mentor.
Right.
And then, so who am I? And then we said that since we have Mindtree, the right expression should be gardener.
Okay.
And it had many subsequent implications, because, you know, a gardener is different from a farmer.
Right.
A farmer looks at his crop as a mass.
Right.
You know,
whereas a gardener is very specific about that one plant.
And every plant is unique.
Nice, nice. So it's 1:1, very 1:1. But why the top 100 only? Is that a number? Why is the number sacrosanct?
Because these people are leading, and if they are not leading right,
okay,
then we have a serious problem.
Sure.
So it is not the best 100,
okay,
but we do presume that the top 100 are some of our,
yeah,
best
you
people.
You presume that cream floats up,
yeah,
to the top.
Yes.
It still is a presumption.
Of course. Of,
okay,
course. Of course.
You know, professionals turning into entrepreneurs, that's a theme with you. What's with it?
Well, I think it is something which is an idea whose time has come.
Okay.
And I don't think necessarily, you know, we are the bellwethers for that. I think the first time we saw that pattern emerging was when the Infosys founders came together.
Right.
Because these were first generation people,
right,
they were professionals,
yeah,
and they did not have legacy, they did not have inheritance.
But it didn't necessarily happen only in IT. It's been happening around in other realms.
Now,
well,
yes.
Yeah.
Now you have Dr. Devi Shetty.
Yes.
You have Sharan Patel.
Sharan Patel.
You have, you know, Captain Gopinath.
Right.
And I believe that the next couple of decades for India will see a huge tidal wave.
Sure.
Because traditionally, last 40, 50 years, to be a professional meant lifetime of servility, lifetime of employment, right. And you converted professional competence into material gain for yourself.
Right.
Now we are seeing a change where professional, ultimate professional gratification is by creating employment.
Right.
Ultimate professional gratification is about not what I gained personally, but what did the country gain.
In many ways, Subroto, isn't it just the first way? I mean, what about the second layer? We have a whole mass of entrepreneurs in this country who could be turning professional. So isn't that also...
I think we have to work on that simultaneously, and that has been largely the theme of my work outside of Mindtree, okay. as an author,
okay.
because I believe that India's future as a global leader would depend largely on how professionally we present ourselves.
Right.
So it's not enough to be an entrepreneur. One needs to understand what does it take to be professional in whatever you are doing.
For instance, Subroto, India is a nation of shopkeepers.
Yes.
We have 14.6 million shopkeepers in this country.
Yes.
Now, if you really look at them, I mean, them turning professional,
yes.
could really, you know, unlock a lot of value.
Amazingly, yes. And, you know, leave aside the shopkeeper who in his or her own way probably is more professional than many of our MBAs.
Right.
Okay, because if you look at the neighborhood Kirana store,
right.
that individual knows every person's right. needs, is extremely good at his job or her job, anticipates. So if you, you know, look at this individual through the filter of some of the world-class attributes of professionalism, may not speak English and so on,
yeah,
but will still qualify.
Yeah.
But the bigger you know, groups of people are people like, you know, the average technician,
yeah.
The average you know, average hospitality industry yeah. person, the plumber.
Right.
Okay. I'll tell you a very interesting example. You know, I was in a national forest the other day, and you have this almost like four-star, you know, four-star facility there. So, and you have the naturalist who is taking us around, and the person sits next to you in the jeep as you go into the jungle, and you cannot sit next to the person because he's reeking of cigarette smoke.
Oh, there you are.
Okay.
There you
are. Now, because nobody has told him,
yeah, yeah,
he doesn't
yeah.
know that it is not enough to be just a naturalist.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Similarly, I'll give you an example. You know, in a five-star hospital the other day, a colleague took a young child, a daughter, you know,
yeah.
10, 11
yeah.
year old daughter who needed physiotherapy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there was an untoward incident, didn't blow up, but got saved because this physiotherapist is just another person who is not really a physiotherapist, but
yeah.
you learned how to massage and then you
right.
suddenly became a physiotherapist.
Right. Right.
But the system has not educated this individual to be gender sensitive,
right.
to know where the lines are.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So you breed a country of professionals and you become world class when the average electrician, the average driver, average technician, average cleaning service individual, average, you know, light boy,
right.
not only understands the nuances of being the professional
right.
In his or her own chosen area, but has affection for the professional.
Absolutely. Now, one last bit before we take a break, Subroto, which is, you know, I have this favorite theme that the Hazif in India, you know, fashionably called the Hazif and the housewife in India, I think there's plenty of potential to unlock there.
Amazingly,
right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, will it happen? Do you believe it's going to happen?
It's happening already. You know, it's happening, and you look at Anita Shah in Bangalore.
Okay.
Okay, this lady, she was a contented housewife.
Okay.
You know, husband in IT sector, two little kids, you know, Gujarati, good-looking woman, married off when she was 21, 22.
Okay.
And at 40, she wakes up and says, is this the purpose of my life? So what does she do? You know, she first of all finds out what is the love in her life outside of her family, and she loves gardens.
Okay.
Okay. So she starts attending garden exhibitions, attends trade shows, goes all the way to Malaysia and
wow.
Singapore, looks at the sources for ceramic urns, and today she runs a you know, outdoor garden shop
okay.
called Hibiscus.
Trust a gardener to really talk about other gardeners. On that count, you know, we're going to take a break with Subroto Bagchi. We'll return. We're with Subroto Bagchi, Mali at Mindtree. Subroto, if you really look at it, a very unlikely hard tech guy wrapped in a very soft tech avatar. How did this right tech Subroto happen?
Well, to begin with, I'm not a hard tech guy, contrary to popular belief. I think, first of all, my upbringing was balanced, between left brain and right brain. Parents, elder brothers, and the fact that for 8 years, first 8 years of my life, I didn't have schooling. Okay. Because my father was posted in a tribal area. There were no schools nearby.
Okay.
So I was completely free to explore.
You could have become a gardener.
Yeah, indeed, I spent a lot of time with my mother helping her to build a garden.
Wow. Okay. And I hear you grow pepper in your home now.
Oh, yes. Yeah. That streak was always there. I don't even call it a streak. I think there was a big piece of me is about the world around me.
Okay.
The moment you do that, then you have an inclusivity.
Yes.
And then you're not just into zeros and ones.
Yeah.
The other thing is, many people probably don't know that I'm not an engineer. I studied political science and strayed into the IT industry.
Wow, so you can be vice chairman at an IT company, at an IT services company, even without being an engineer, and do exceedingly well. Subroto, if you really look at the latest controversy that's on, Obama and protectionism, what's your take on it?
I think it is unfortunate that the US administration is making the Indian IT industry a whipping boy. It is unfair at many levels, because I think it's very important not to make it an electoral issue. The United States has some serious fundamental structural economic problems, and economic problems cannot be solved with political rhetoric.
Sure. But Subroto, let me hold a big candle for President Obama. If I was to say that, protectionism, particularly when the jobs of your own people comes up in mind, particularly when the lifestyles and the very fabric, social fabric gets into question, isn't protectionism a nice guard to put on?
Yes, it is. And what causes me concern is the recent pronouncement that President Obama made while visiting school children.
Right.
And saying that, your counterparts in Bangalore are studying hard, so
yeah,
you study hard.
Yeah.
Now, is that the right thing to do?
Yeah.
You don't want to create a sense of divide and sense of unfair competition where we are telling our children, go kiss the world.
Yes.
Okay. Right. And you don't want to plant these things in people's mind.
Right.
The problem with somebody like President Obama making pronouncements is that they have a life of their own.
Yeah. And it gets grabbed and it rolls,
yes,
cascades. Let me come back to Indian IT. Indian IT is a very exocentric business. It's got very little to do with India. IT services, ITES.
Not anymore.
Why is this so? 60 billion years.
Yeah, how is your cell phone working?
60 billion years dollars. If I look at export revenue, 60 billion years.
Yes,
dollars,
yes.
What a small pittance of it coming from out of India. When is this going to deepen in India? Where are we?
Oh, it's
more IT.
It is happening. The largest IT deals for India are happening in India.
Okay.
And you'll be amazed, when we won the Aadhaar deal,
right,
we actually picked Accenture and IBM to,
yeah,
win it.
Yeah.
And it is one of the most significant, largest deals ever.
Okay.
In a short time frame. But more than us winning that deal against IBM and Accenture, is the total deployment cost of that will be one of the largest that
so
one
this
has
is
ever
getting
known.
Evened out, you say.
Of course.
It'll take how many years?
Oh, I think by 2020, if we are a developed country,
okay,
it has to match a developed country's IT spend, and it is happening.
But again, by 2020, Subroto, India is going to be a $7 trillion economy. We're going to be the third largest economy in the world. Even then, even in 2020, the gap between the haves and the have-nots is very, very, very dramatic. How does that get bridged?
That's got nothing to do with IT. I think if you look at a recent CNN news report, 14% of Americans are considered poor.
Okay.
Okay. It is one of the most accessorized countries in the world.
Okay.
So you're 14%, you know, when you talk about 33% Indians below the poverty line, yeah. The US is 14% of Americans is poor. You got a serious issue there. So I think it is not about IT, it is about political leadership of a different kind.
Okay.
I think the world is ready for moving on from the last 100 years of what dominated political thinking and also economic thinking.
Okay. Patience among the young is totally dead in our country, you know, today. Young, particularly young, I mean the young are restless. Is it good? Is it bad?
I think young always were restless. Plato was famously quoted as saying that the youngsters of his generation are not listening to the older ones and they're pursuing their own thing.
Okay. You like youngsters to listen to the older ones?
Actually, when I'm talking to younger ones, I try to step into their head because inside of their head, there is the future. Inside my head is the past.
Okay.
So I gain much more by getting into their head.
Okay.
And it is important that the young question the borders and push it than to live in a world created by us.
Okay. The young must not live in a world created by the old. I'm with Subroto Bagchi. We'll get back after this break. I'm with Subroto Bagchi. Subroto, you were not born with a silver spoon or let's say a silver hard disk. tell me about that.
Well, I was born to a small-time government servant in Orissa. My father had migrated to Orissa in the 1930s and he moved from place to place. He retired with a salary of 300 rupees, which probably in current terms is like 2,500 rupees.
Okay.
I was born in a house in a place called Patnagarh, which most people have not heard about. It had no electricity or running water. I saw running water and electricity for the first time when I was 8 years old. So, but I tell you, it is not about, I thought that was the silver spoon though. You know, depending on what you mean
by. That's a nice one. You know, this tough thing, which one starts with, that really gets you there. But you know, our children seem to have easier lives. Are our children actually getting lazy?
The answer is, you know, what do you mean by our children?
Okay. In many ways,
the
next generation, you know, the urban children.
Yes.
It's quite likely that, you know, somebody who comes from a privileged home,
yes.
And Subroto Bagchi's home is a privileged home as far as I'm concerned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you really look at it, the second generation is taking everything for granted. Now, does this, really blunt the edge?
No, it doesn't.
A person like you had?
It doesn't because, you know, for one bunch of urban kids who are turning lazy, you know, there are thousands of meek who will inherit the earth.
Wonderful.
Okay.
So what you're saying is, it's not 1:1, it's cyclical. You know, prosperity will not always reign in the homes of those who have become prosperous in the first gen.
Yeah.
Okay.
Tell me how many rich kids in your class actually scored more marks than you?
Yeah.
So the kid who will always, you know, top the class will be from a meek background.
Somebody with hunger in the belly.
Yeah.
Okay. What was the worst blunder the gardener has ever made in his life? If you were to think of the worst blunder.
Well, mistakes I can remember, but blunders, I do not.
Okay.
Because I have always felt that there's an angelic hand on my shoulder.
Okay.
That keeps me away from it.
Nice. An angelic hand on the shoulder. If you really look at corporate politics, Subroto, a lot of young people who work similarly in IT or non-IT are very worried about corporate politics. What's this animal all about and when is it going to vanish?
It will never vanish because I think every organization has a degree of politics, but politicization is a different thing.
Yeah.
And usually it's a function of size. And it's a function of also, you know, the values of an organization and the top management.
Okay.
I think the issue is not to wish it away, but to say, hey, how do I work with it? And sometimes, how do I work against it?
Okay, personally, Subroto, you know, there's a quest of happiness, which a lot of people run behind. Have you found happiness yourself?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
In what?
You know, to me, the definition of happiness is your capacity to create something extraordinary with ordinary people.
Okay.
To make a difference to people who are twice removed from your lives.
Okay.
The moment you do that, that is sustainable happiness.
Yeah, and millions of pieces of blessings.
Of course, of course, of course.
Do you, Subroto Bagchi, believe in afterlife?
Yes and no. Yes, because I'm very sure that I'll be grass. And in fact, I have always told my wife that though I'm a Hindu, born into a family of a Brahmin, I should not be cremated because then you are waste.
Okay.
I should be buried.
Yeah.
So you become grass. But will I become another human being with another life?
Yeah.
You know, will I get into the court of the high heavens? Yeah. The answer is no. Yeah.
Must you be a human being at all, in fact?
Yeah, you know.
But why? Why? Go kiss the world. What's with the kiss and Subroto Bagchi?
Well, when my mother was on her deathbed, I went to see her, and I'm her youngest born, so I was always very spoiled. So as I was leaving her, I hugged her and kissed her forehead. She was paralyzed.
Wow.
In a garbled voice, she asked me in Bengali, "Why are you kissing me?" So I retorted, I said, "Why not?" To that, she said, "Go kiss the world."
Wow. What? Subroto Bagchi, what's the best thing that's happened to Bangalore post-IT?
I think the best thing that has happened to Bangalore post-IT is this ecosystem of creativity. You know, people like yourself, people that we see in media, people like Arundhati Nag, who are today iconic in a national sense, who are not just making theatre here, but people like Ramesh Ramanathan, you know, who are telling how to reinvent citizenry, even the politicians.
And
the artists.
What's the worst thing that's happened post-IT?
I think post-IT, the worst thing that we have done is that we have overrun the city.
Okay.
We have pushed the infrastructure down.
Okay.
And I think we have lost a little bit of Bangalore because Bangalore has become too much of a migrant city.
Okay. What's the biggest setback Subroto Bagchi has ever had in life?
No,
positive way of looking at life.
No, well, not bad, but you know, if I start complaining and I talk about setbacks, now
100 plants will start complaining.
It's an unfair thing.
There's no end to it. It's a cascade of complaints. You're not a complaining guy.
No, I'm not.
Okay. What's your idea for a relaxed holiday?
You know, we do it all the time. So it is Sushmita and me, and walking endlessly through old cities.
Okay. Wow.
And then my conning her into, you know, letting me drink beer at the end of it. But
this is a lovely, lovely passion.
Yes.
Now, which was the last city you went to?
Well, we were in Praha about 4 weeks back.
Wow.
And prior to that, we took about 3 days in a vineyard in Germany.
Wow.
And all the time, we run away into Kabini.
Wow, you know, nice. So. Now, let me come to the pep cue questions, the ending part of this interview with you, Subroto. Quick questions addressed to you with quick answers. What's the single biggest check you have ever written? What value?
My wife writes the checks.
And the smallest ever check written by your wife?
Probably 5 rupees.
Okay. I won't ask for what. In a typical day, what gives you the most joy?
You know, the capacity to see smile on my people's face.
If your boss, if you had one, or if you have one, were to describe you in one sentence, how would he describe you?
Difficult, unpredictable, moody, intuitive, creative, articulate.
If your immediate subordinate was to describe you, how would he describe you?
Somebody that he can trust and somebody he can, you know, have confidence in.
If your real boss, Sushmita, your wife, was to describe you, how would she describe you?
Childhood sweetheart.
Oh, nice. Okay. If you were to rephrase this, how would you rephrase
no,
it?
No. She will call me a pain when I'm at home.
You're protecting yourself. Okay. If you were to rephrase this, how would you rephrase this? The pen is mightier than the
sword.
I don't live to eat, I live to
fly.
What were the exact percentage of marks you received in your 10th standard?
We didn't have a 10th standard, we had 11.
11. Okay. In 11, yeah. What did you?
You don't want to know.
You don't want to tell?
62%.
Okay. In the next exam, which was critical to you, what was the exact number of marks you got?
I was the second in the university. Ooh. And I had 84%.
Okay. When was the last time you quarreled with Sushmita?
Actually, I have never quarreled. You know, all I do is I admit my mistakes. Okay. And rub
when
my
was
nose.
The last time Sushmita quarreled with you?
She doesn't quarrel, actually. Once in 6 months, probably. Okay. And it's not a quarrel. I think we probably get on each other's nerves a little bit. Okay. There are no issue-based quarrels.
Everybody does get on. Everybody is nervous. Subroto Bagchi, thank you for your philosophy. Thank you for having me in your home today. And thank you for being with me on Salt and Pep with me.
Thank you, Harish. Thank you so much.
Lovely meeting you, Subroto.
Thank you. Absolutely delightful.